Hey, it's Fran, again. And I'm in the historic John Wanamaker building in Philadelphia. And I'm here to do something really special. Because that behind me, behind that artificial facade, is the world's largest functioning musical instrument. And it's the Wanamaker Organ, which was installed here around 1910. And I am Scott Kipp, who is one of the people who actually takes care of this very impressive instrument. He's going to give me an inside tour, literally, inside of this behemoth instrument, the largest musical instrument in the world, the Wanamaker Organ. And it's pretty exciting. This building, it was made a national landmark, and so it's actually a protected building, but you could read all about it. I'll post some links in the description. But those of you who love really bad movies, as I do, know this building really well from the 1987 smash flop Mannequin. And I can still see Kim Cattrall dancing in the organ loft. Anyway, I'm really excited about this one. In fact, this will probably have to be a two-parter because there's just so much to see and so many details. So I figured we'd get right into it with going inside the organ and take a look at the inside. Wow. This is just amazing, like that all this is, you know, quarantined off. This is such a significant part of the building.
Yeah, there's a beautiful archway on the floor down that way.
Wow. There's City Hall across the way. Yeah, City Hall. Wow, and all these beautiful tile floors and everything. Good asbestos tile.
Yeah. Yeah,
highly resilient. There you go.
Hey.
I'm just getting a wide angle shot of all this. These narrow passageways. This is something. Look at this. This is all cut off. All cut off from the. It just goes on and on.
New a couple of years ago. It was a nicer view before they built it, but look at this nice archway they just boxed in here.
Huh. Wow. A nondescript store in the ladies' department. It's inside the organ. This is amazing. Oh my God. I can hear the valves clicking and clacking.
Yeah.
Look at this bellows. This thing's huge. Is this a reservoir?
Yeah.
It's like the size of a minivan.
Right here.
Oh wow. Oh god, yeah, I can hear the film turning on and off. Someone scrawled their name on that one. Look at this. This is amazing. You have to be very thin to be able to get through the bowels of the organ. It's, there's definitely a width limit.
Gone, you could cut through, but we'll go the other way.
Wow. Those pipes are like, oh, I don't know what, 20 feet long? I can feel the wind coming out of the pipes hit me in the face. Those bass notes, you could, pipes. It has big bellows there. The bellows going up and down. See that?
Mm-hmm.
That's like a big reservoir.
That is a reservoir.
These are really big. Wow. That's like 14 inches wide or so. Wow, look at these. It's huge.
So here's one of the chambers. So we're in the original part of the organ, the 1902-03.
Oh my god. That's how wide the door is. It's about 13 inches wide. Door. 13-inch door. Wow. It is cramped. Oh.
You have to be careful not to touch the pipes because they go out of tune really easily.
Yeah, I can imagine that would
be the
case.
They're easy to bump, so you'd have to be careful. Well, that's the tremulant, which is a thing that rhythmically dumps wind out of the wind chest to create a vibrato sound on the pipes. You can see the swell shades on the front. This is what controls the volume.
Shades?
Yeah.
Oh, shades.
Yeah. So each pipe plays one note at one volume. So they enclose them in big soundproof chambers like this, and then open and close the swell shades to let more or less of the sound out.
So this is volume control.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Wow.
But
it was moving a second ago.
There's some more pipes there. like, what, 2 stories tall, give or take? Wow. Oh my God. We're going up and up. Look at this. This is beautiful. These pipes are massive. Oh, this is dizzying. It just goes on and on. Look at that. So we're on the second story. Another layer. Another rune.
It's a little bigger than the blue pot.
Yeah, a little bit bigger. It's interesting that all the pipes on this have this kind of weird galvanized kind of speckling. Is that some kind of special treatment or zinc? Or
I think that's, well, there probably is zinc in them. Like I said, I don't know much about the metallurgy of the pipes.
Yeah, it's like a kind of galvanization. You got a pipe that's kind of kiltered there. You got kind of one that's a little tilted there.
Yeah, that means that there's a cipher, which is what they call it when a note sticks on. Could happen for any number of mechanical reasons, and the quick way to fix that is just pull the pipe out and set it aside. So the pipes just sit so the board that they're in is called the toe board, or the rack board rather. It just racks them, keeps them in place, and then underneath the rack board there is a toe board that the pipe toe just sits in for gravity, so they just lift out. So if you have one that's just speaking constantly and won't shut off, and you don't have time to fix it, you can just pull it out and move to the side.
These are all labeled, very conveniently, often. This is like, these are the different voices, viola, violette, viola. So is that the voice?
Yes, exactly. So on the console, there's a tab that says that. And if you press that tab, it lets me to the chest and under that.
So it's like, this
is, you can play that right.
That's viola, viola. That's ear-burstingly loud.
What's that?
That's ear-burstingly loud.
Yeah.
Wow. the loudest thing I've ever heard in my life.
Oh man, this is level 6, 7, 7th level.
It's not usually, you know, you should play that loud.
It's really loud.
Sorry about that.
Well, I brought earplugs, but they're about 10 levels down.
Careful, don't bang your head, careful.
So I'm very tall.
So we're in the string division now.
Wow.
I know this wasn't more than you bargained for.
Well, it's definitely loud.
So this is part of the one of the enlargements that they did to the instrument. So this was originally retail space, and then in the 20s they turned it into an organ chamber.
So how many levels up? We went through several levels, six, seven.
We're on the 4th floor of the building now.
But I mean, for this organ, this is like the.
Yeah, it's about 5 stories tall. And there is more above us that. You can't, it's not directly connected. You have to go through people's offices to get there, so we're not going to go. But
yeah.
There is more to it than we'll see. Like,
how does the sound for all this get out there?
Again, there's swell shades on the front.
It's like a submarine. This is a lot like.
Division up at the ceiling on the opposite side, and the ethereal division is on the side we're on, also at the ceiling.
That's the echo division.
Yeah, across the bed. Wow. Okay, we should go back in. Each of these blowers is for a different division.
Wow.
So this goes to the string division where we cut the rubber. So this is the orchestral division of the organ, which is the first big restoration project that we did. And this is Mrs. Brickman, who funded the project. That's her wedding photo. And this is kind of an amazing story. There used to be, when this was Lord & Taylor, there was sort of a crappy little cafe that they had in here. My boss was eating lunch one day with some of the volunteers, and this little old lady approached him and said that she and her husband used to listen to the organ all the time, and he had passed away, and she wanted to know if she could do anything to help the organ. She lived downtown, you know, came here for lunch a couple times a week. And so they gave her their fundraising menu, and the top item on the menu was move the orchestral division. And she said, I'd like to do it. So that's what this chamber here is. So this is, so Mrs. Brickman said that she would fund the restoration and moving of the orchestral division. So this is one of the chambers of the organ that was buried in the very back, and only had these, like, I'm gonna start again, had these five small swell shades that had to let out all of the sound of this whole chamber. And so it could never be heard very well, and so at some point they stopped fixing it, and just no one had heard it since the early 70s, we think. So we took this entire chamber out of the organ, out that hatch that we climbed through. Everything in this room came out that hatch. And so the wind chests in here that are 13 feet long, that's why we had to extend the elevator, because all the stuff in here had to fit in our elevator and come up to our shop. So we pulled everything out, renovated our shop space, brought the stuff to the shop, rebuilt this division, and then also we built this room. This used to be office space, but the building let us have it for the organ. So we built this room, and the walls here are, this is the actual thickness of the walls. I think they're about 10 inches thick. Several layers of drywall with studs on 4-inch centers, or no, 6-inch centers, I think. It's ridiculous, but this is how thick the walls are. And then the walls of the chamber, the inside walls are 1-inch MDF. And then put the organ in. We actually built this framework to hold everything up off the ground so you can get under the chests and take the bottom ports down and work on the organ. And this, the support structure here is just a reproduction of what's in the string division where we just were. Because like the organ downstairs that we were in is all designed as like a self-contained sort of unit, and it's designed so that you can get at everything and take the bottom boards down and work on the chests. But like in the string division there, originally it was retail space, so it wasn't designed to hold an organ. So they built that framework to hold the chests up off the ground so you could get underneath them and work on it. And so we just reproduced what they had in the other room when we put these chests in. So this is a, well, like I said, this is the first big project that we did. And so this is about a 2-year project that took 3 years. And you know how that goes.
Yeah.
So this was finished in 2008. And really, tragically, Mrs. Brickman passed away just before we finished. So she didn't quite get to hear it, which is a shame. But that's Mrs. Brickman as I knew her. She was in her 90s when she came. She's a really, really great lady.
All right.
And still, you know, she walked here every day from her apartment up the street. Would come have lunch with us and sit in the shop sometimes, or we'd take her up to the chamber so she could see how it was progressing.
Can we take a look upstairs?
Oh, you mean in? Yeah, go ahead.
I'll follow. Well, some of these pipes are amazingly tiny. Like less than a size of a screw. And these pipes can actually be heard, even though they're microscopic. I mean, we're actually hearing these little guys as well as the...
Yeah, and it all combines, but yeah. Oh yeah, he turned it off. Okay.
Oh, it is off.
Down. Yeah, the pressure's going down.
Oh, the blowers are off.
Mm-hmm.
Phew. That was a short one, short concert.
Yeah.
So what are we hearing now?
I don't know.
Something squeaking?
I don't know what that is.
Sounds like a dog. Could there be a dog?
An upset dog? Probably not.
This is just a work of art. I mean, this is just...
Yeah, well, we spent a lot of hours in this room.
So how many pipes are in this room altogether? Just this one room?
I don't know. I guess it's...
Again, some of these pipes are microscopically small on the organ scale. I
guess there might be about 1,000 in here. I forget how many ranks. Okay, so what to talk about? So okay. So basically the way the chambers are laid out, these chests are diatonic, meaning that there's a C side and a sharp side. So the pipes go every other note from the center here to the sides is one rank of pipes. And the chests are diatonic. So there is C and then C sharp, D and D sharp, and it just goes back and forth from the sides to the center, from low to high, which does a bunch of things. It it balances out the weight of the instrument, and it also spaces the pipes out, which I think makes them a little easier to tune. What else? I guess that's about it. That's about it for that. Also in terms of the way chambers are laid out, so the front of the chamber is there with the swell shades, and the audience is out there. And the way organ chambers are usually laid out is all of the pipes of the same note are in rows front to back in the chamber. So the notes run front to back. And then the ranks, or the voices, the stops, run side to side. So it's basically a grid. And we could go underneath and look, but there are bottom boards. Okay, we'll back up. So there's every chamber has at least one thing that's called the primary, and it's a big wind chest, similar to the organ chest. It's filled with pressure from the blowers. But it's the thing that takes the 12-volt electrical signal from the console and translates it into a pneumatic signal. So the primaries run parallel to the ranks. And the primary has bottom boards that connect to it and go out underneath all of the chests. And there is channeling that runs through the bottom boards and connects to each of the notes that are all in the same pitch, front to back. So there's, you know, a middle C magnet in the primary, and then there's a channel in the bottom board that mates up with the leather gaskets to every middle C pneumatic on that chest, right? So the organist plays middle C, and it sends 12 volts up to that middle C magnet, which lifts a little metal armature, and it exhausts that channel to atmosphere. And that channel is connected to those Fleming pneumatics that you saw in the shop, and so it exhausts all of the Fleming pneumatics that are of that pitch to the atmosphere. But only the chests that have been turned on with a stop tab have wind in them, generally speaking. Only the chests that have been turned on with a stop tab have wind in them. So only the pipes, or only the notes that have wind in the chest will actually speak. So it's kind of like a physical version of the wiring in the relay that you saw, where if the note is played and the stop is turned on, then the pipe speaks. But it's sort of mechanical. You know what I mean?
Now you said that the... The relays used to be all electromechanical, and then it's been updated. Now it's there's some more solid state control.
Yes.
So what do you still have like pieces of the original electromechanical?
It's
all still in place.
Oh yeah, it's all still wired. It's all still there. Oh,
okay.
So we could, in theory, disconnect the electronic relay and reconnect the electromechanical.
You always have the option of backwinding.
Yes, which I think is really good because, I mean. You know, people, there's different ways to look at it. Like, are we trying to keep the organ as original as possible? Or are we trying to make it work the best we can? And the way we do things here is we try to make it work better while still respecting the original sort of, the original instrument itself. We do try to make it work better.
Again, and I'm back at the historic John Wanamaker building in Center City, Philadelphia, for part two of the Wanamaker organ, which is behind me. Scott Kipp is with me again, and we're going to go over and take a look at the console that is used to control this largest musical instrument in the world. Scott, so part one of the video that we shot, there were lots of comments about the battle between the Wanamaker organ, that's the largest musical instrument in the world, and the organ that's in New Jersey.
Well, I'm not as familiar with the Atlantic City organ. You could say it depends, which is bigger, depends upon how you measure. We have more ranks. But they have another octave on their manuals, and they end up having more pipes. But they also have some bigger scale pipes than we have. They actually have a 64-foot open diapason where there's the pipes are built in and it's 64-foot tall resonator, which we don't have. We have, you know, 32-foot open. And in terms of just cubic feet of space that it takes up, that's bigger. Theirs is bigger.
But how much of it is actually functional?
That they've gotten so much more of it working in the past year that I guess my answer would be I don't know. But there's quite a lot more done than there was this time just a year ago. They're going crazy down there. It's super busy and they're doing amazing work.
So at least for the time of this filming, it's the Wanamaker Organ is still maintaining the title.
Yeah, but
Who knows?
They're both. I don't know. Unique in their own way. I think the Wanamaker Organ is. Of course, I'm speaking as if I like play the organ or in any way musically trained, which I'm not. But I think the Wanamaker Organ is much more subtle. Like it's made for subtlety, despite the fact that it's big and can play loud. Its subtlety is its sort of strength. And I guess remains to be seen how much of that though we'll be able to get out of the Atlantic City organ. I don't really know.
Why don't you introduce?
So this is Matt Taft, the organ shop coordinator at Macy's, and he can explain the
the console.
Musical workings of the console.
You have a keyboard that we refer to as a manual, and there are six here, and one for your feet. That's the pedals are bigger and don't have the full scope of the whole keyboard. But each one of these manuals, you can assign different instruments to them, and each instrument section has a different correlated color tab to it. And it ranges from orchestral sounds like flutes, tibias, that's mostly what's in there, flutes and tibias. We've got a section of tabs to make sounds like human voices called the Vox Humana, and that's a whole room of several sets of these pipes. There's a section of the choir. There are string instruments that fill up the entire fourth floor of the organ, and pedal pipes that are 32 feet tall and so big you can put a pony in the top of it. And it's just a really amazing thing that there are structures that are so big and just get scaled down to several inches tall and such a smaller diameter, and each one is an individual musical note. If you put on this tab that says 8-foot trumpet and you press down the low C, there is one pipe that is 8 feet tall that makes the pitch of low C, and there's a reed in there to vibrate because we don't have little lips to vibrate on each one like you would playing a trumpet. There's one pipe that's 8 feet long to play that one note of the trumpet. And then there's another pipe that's a little bit shorter for the next note up. And then another one, and another one, 61 times. And oftentimes there's an extra octave at the top when you want a couple things. So there are 73 notes for this one tab.
And by notes, he also means pipes.
Pipes, yeah.
So 73 individual objects that are each individually adjusted and tuned mechanically to be in relationship to each, and that's just on one tab, and then each of those tabs, for the most part, has that. So that's why there's so much of the organ.
Thousands and tens of thousands of pipes, individually handmade and hand-maintained, with all of their own little series of actions and pneumatics to make the air flow through them to play.
So explain the various sections of the console and what differentiates them.
Choir, then the great, then the swell, then the solo, then the ethereal and stentor.
Stentor?
Yes. You can assign each of the colored tabs. They're home assigned to those layers. So you're conducting like you're an orchestra conductor, and you make these instruments play with these fingers here, and then when you want to conduct the other part of the orchestra, you move your hands up to something else. And you turn them on by tilting the tabs down, and you could do that again and again and again and again individually with all your fingers, but you're doing this live, and you're playing the music, so you have to have pre-assigned combinations of these tabs that have turned on, and that's what these round buttons are underneath. And you push them as you play, and if the console was on, it would energize the coils that Scott probably showed you inside to make the tabs move one direction or the other.
How many of these pre-programmed preset buttons are there that can be programmed? It's quite a number, I know.
If you pause, I can count, and then.
But it's a number for each. Yeah. So each rank, would these be ranks?
Ranks.
Okay.
And so you would push your piston, and it would go back. The signal would go to this. Did you show her?
Yeah, we looked on the inside.
Yeah. So that goes to the combination action, and then the electrical signals would be spat back out to turn the coils on or off.
And these all get the tablets, is that what they
call? Yes.
They all get flipped by an actuator in the console.
Yeah.
Based on what's pre-programmed and for that setting, and this is for the entire organ can be changed in one button.
One button.
And when they rock down or back, it is mechanically connecting an electrical signal that goes into the organ and turns on or off a rank of pipes.
So
there is a mechanical connection, a mechanical electrical connection being made when they move, which is what sends the signals into the organ, which then turns on the divisions. And then there's the notes. So there's the stop signaling, and then there's the note signaling.
And as we pointed out before I started shooting, even these, are these original light fixtures for
yeah.
the organ?
Yeah, yeah.
So these original light fixtures for the organ, they take tungsten tubes for illumination.
Long filaments.
It's an actual tungsten filament. It's not a fluorescent tube, but a tungsten tube, which I noticed that they do flicker. Like this one's flickering. It probably doesn't show up on the video because of the frame rate, but it's actually the tungsten bulb that the filament kind of wobbling around from the heat. So as I understand it, you have an electron supply of those replacement bulbs.
Yes.
Just in case.
So you can have the sounds turn on or off, your pre-programmed combinations of sounds, sort of like a radio station. And we can even have, just to throw in, FM1, FM2. So each organist can have their own preset combinations. And that goes up to like FM 100 for us. But you have the stops on, you're pressing down on the keys, air's flowing through the pipes, and music is coming out. Then there are these little gas pedal shaped things that you use to control the volume of the pipes. If the pipes are in a room that's enclosed with shades, they're like Venetian blinds, but for sound. And instead of light, it's sound. So
yeah.
when you
Which
press
Which we saw in episode one.
Episode one, we yes. saw the swirl shades. And we even saw the actuator that controls the swirl shades.
And you slide it up and down with your foot here, or on the manual, you can also have the expression open and closed. So if your feet are busy playing notes, you can be using your thumb.
So let me see that close up of that. So you actually have a little slider there, and that's doing exactly the same thing as the foot control.
You've got it.
All right, so you can do it by hand or by foot.
Oh, something else I want to point out since we're here.
Yeah.
And this I think isn't hooked up anymore because we've redone the combination action. But in the days before cell phones were so common, Kurt, the curator who also worked for the telephone company for many, many years, I don't think he installed the phone, but there's this phone here, which is still hooked up, but Kurt made it so that...
when you picked up the receiver.
When you picked up the receiver, you could make it so that these numbers here would actually dial the telephone, and it was connected to the phone lines in the building.
The numbers here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I mean, these are buttons for the combination action, but you
but
could make it,
phone.
But Kurt made it so they were also hooked into the phone, and you could dial and make phone calls from the console using that phone.
And of course it is a 1930s era handset, so.
Yeah, but I think that's not hooked up anymore because when we redid the console, well, I mean, the phone is hooked up. I don't think you can dial from there. But you can call that phone. And Kurt actually made it so that if the organ console was turned on, instead of the phone ringing, it would make the crescendo light there flash. So the organist would know the phone was ringing, but it wouldn't make a noise because they were playing.
That's awesome.
awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
But it might be disconnected now.
So we have made some changes to this. When the orchestra came in 2008, Peter needed to be able to see the conductor, and so they had me make this drop-down screen, which was made for, you know, installing in SUVs or whatever to entertain the children. But we put this here, so now we have a camera feed that can look at the conductor, and so Peter can play. So I try to find ways to blend things like that in and not have the console look any different. And like I said, this was all built in the building here, which I think is pretty cool. So I just mounted it on the back there.
Nice. It's good work.
Yeah. I kind of want to remake it out of metal now that I'm learning how to make things out of metal, but.
So you're saying this whole thing, all of the components, all the woodworking, all the metalworking was all done in the building?
Yeah, this is all built in the building. And then also we have a new combination action. So the CA is the thing that records the settings, the registrations that the organists have, basically where the tabs are set. And we have a new electronic memory in the organ that takes care of that. So we put those components here in this drawer, which I also need to, I kind of want to take the time and remake it. But this is the, you know, fun kind of thing I get to do. You know, occasionally I get to make pretty dovetail drawers too.
Wow. And you made that. You made this from scratch.
Yeah. Oh, God, it's attached with wires. Yeah, it's, you can't really see it. I was going to flip it over, but it's just packed with so much crap underneath there that I really want to make another one.
Yeah, look at that. So that's in the shot we usually don't see is the, and again, this is interesting because it is a keyboard. You have the black keys and the white keys in pedal form. And what are the buttons called?
Toe studs.
Toe studs.
They are pistons for your feet. And like you have the numbered pistons for your thumbs under the manuals, you've got pre-programmed ones that you can push with your feet.
And each one is named. You've got choir, grade, swell, solo, ethereal,
stentor,
okay.
Yeah. And crescendo.
Studs. 2D FF. Bombard, diaphone, gamba. These are all nicknames, I guess.
The black tabs are ranks.
Ranks. Diaphone.
Diaphone.
So that is a lot.
It's really cool. And the 2Ds are sort of the three-stage crescendo, where you can activate a bunch of stops at one time by pushing that with your foot. It's a pre-programmed, mechanically programmed section of the organ that you have to go back and turn these little metal like rings on or off, and that when you press 2D1 the electrical signals go through that matrix that's still in line today, that bypasses the computer circuitry.
So some of it is still, some of the programming is still left,
you can be done mechanically by hand.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's the 2Ds. The electronic combination action that we have now is an upgraded hybrid system, because there was an electronic combination action put in before. There's the combination action and the relay. Both are huge upgrades.
What is the relay?
The relay is the relay race of information. You're passing the baton of, you know, you press down a key and it completes an electrical circuit. And that electrical signal then needs to travel to somewhere else, and that's the baton that's being passed. And you relay that information to throughout the organ to the different parts that need to work. And that, we have a lot of still mechanical relays, but we bypassed these old mechanical relays. It's a tall wooden block with a bunch of metal fingers on it that would inflate, and those metal fingers would touch contacts and then relay those electrical signals that are being generated when you press down on the keys to the pipes that have air pressurized underneath them to make them play. And we've bypassed the mechanical Rube Goldberg make this happen, then that happen to make 10 other things just keep going in succession. And it's a much more instantaneous, create this electrical signal and within, I think it's 8 milliseconds, the signal gets to the valve for the note to play.
So this was something that Scott had mentioned before, that to play this organ, you have to be accustomed to the delay.
Yes.
So it's not like a modern synthesizer or an even electrical organ. You have to wait for what you're playing to be heard.
There was an organist who used to hum a different tune than he was playing, because if you listen to what you're playing, it just gets slower and slower and slower, and you would get so far out of time, so he would be whistling a different tune so his fingers could keep time.
So there's the time interval that it takes just to actuate the note that you press, but then there's also the time it takes for the sound to reach the console, because some of these organ pipes are quite far away.
Yes, and the echo division is, I think, about 120 feet in the air. And then there's that compound delay that happens with the mechanical relays, and then the air that has to go through the pipe and then make this pipe sound, and that distance is greater when you have taller pipes. So
there's actually a greater delay with the lower notes.
Yes.
Than with the higher notes. So playing this organ isn't a matter of like improvising by listening to what you're playing. You're mechanically pressing the keys based on sheet music, basically, and tuning out what you're hearing, because you're not hearing what you're playing.
You've sort of just got to know how to feel what to play and not necessarily hear what you're playing. But the hearing part is important when you're registering the organ and figuring out which sounds you want to come out underneath which fingertips and feet.
Right. So yeah. It is a skill, to like a somewhat detached way of playing but controlling the organ.
Yes.
In a delay of time.
And as a fixer-upper, that's my perspective. Yes, I could barely comprehend how to, you know, I dabble playing the piano, and this is like playing the drums with pianos on your fingertips, and conducting three symphony orchestras at the same time. It's mind-boggling, and I have so much respect for artists who do this and do this well.
Well, thanks, Matt. Thanks for showing us the whole thing.
Yeah.
Great.
Cool.
You said you recently converted it to have a microcontroller as opposed to, originally it was all electromechanical memory for those selections, correct?
Yes, and the original combination action, they said, I've never seen it, I think we have blueprints of it, but they said it never worked. Right. So I think there's a video online of someone, it might be Keith Chapman in the 80s playing concert here, and he's adjusting all the tabs by hand, which is really crazy. Anyway, okay, so this is the inside of the console. So these are the bolster rails that run behind the tabs. So each of the tabs you see on the front has two electromagnets, one to turn it on, one to turn it off. And the console runs on vacuum, not on pressure. Sort of like a player piano. It's a small enough system that it can run on vacuum. So it uses the, you know, regular atmospheric pressure to move the tabs instead of building up pressure to counteract the atmosphere and then building on top of that, if that makes any sense. There's vacuum that runs in all these pipes, and then there's actually these oak bolster rails are hollow on the inside. And the electromagnets turn each tab on or off. The tabs, electrically and pneumatically, still work the same way they always have. It's just the signal that goes to them to turn them on or off is, you know, recorded and recalled electronically now instead of mechanically. But so each of those tabs has a pneumatic like this. So this is actually two. So they get screwed in here, and so one of them flips the tab up, and another one flips the tab down. And there's a rocker, and we have all the original jigs that they made that you set this in to do the re-leathering.
How many of these are in the console?
I don't know. I think 460. I'm probably wrong.
It's hundreds.
Hundreds for sure. I'm not pedantic enough to know how many there are.
For maintenance, how often do you typically have to replace those, or if ever?
Well, they redid most of the console in the 90s, I think, in the late 90s. So now if we do something, it's we might take one out and have to patch it here and there. I mean, it's really... Well, here, come on in. It's the console is... It could be worse to work on, but it's not great. We've done some things to try to make it easier, but... so this is the back of the six manuals. It may be hard to see, but there is... each of the keys here, you know, so these are the back of the keys on the keyboard. And there's a little loop of wire with a single wire in the center, and these little bars just short the loop to the center part. And these all have to be regulated because, you know, that you want each key on the keyboard to depress to the same depth as all of it, all of the other keys. And also with sort of the same amount of force required to press it down. So this all has to get carefully adjusted when it comes apart. But so to get at this, you have to, like this panel here, this is the back of the post for the music rack that I showed you. So this unscrews and the wires stay attached and it just kind of, you pull it out, it takes two or three people and it gets kind of pulled out from the front and then we lay it on the top. And then, where are the pivot points, that then the manuals actually lift up so you can get underneath them. But it's a real chore. Recently, one of the, so also there are those memory buttons with the numbers on them. Recently, one of those came detached from the very back on the inside, and we had to, and it was the second to lowest keyboard, and we had to unscrew all of them and lift them all up and just barely get in there to fix one little nut that came loose.
This
I mean, it took, sorry, you know, like 5 hours.
This bar here, it's, I see, I'm looking at the mechanism here, this this bar, it goes over to this actuator here that goes all the way up here to this bellows. What is that?
This is the crescendo, which I don't know if he uses it very often, but it's got a big light in the way here, but here are all the contacts. There's a big sort of a brass plate, it's okay, a big brass plate that slides down and contacts.
And these on the bottom, these are the foot controls.
These are the swell shades. So each one has 10 different levels between fully closed and fully open.
Now this is all electromechanical rather than pneumatic. Is there any vacuum in there? No.
This is just your foot presses it, and you know, so it's you know. It's just a block of maple with a piece of brass on either side and contacts. So this is all, you know, like I said, this is all from the original.
And that, we
shop.
Saw that swell shade controller upstairs last time, and so how does this get translated into that pneumatic actuation happening upstairs?
It just gets sent electrically. I think originally it was 12 volts, but now we have the new electronic relay, so it's probably 5 or something like that.
Is it motor controlled up there? Does it open up valves to...
It depends. There are a lot of different swell shades in the organ. There's some... The original ones were pneumatic. There's a thing called a whiffle tree, which is what I was told it was called. It seems crazy, but there's a thing called a whiffle tree. It's a 10-stage pneumatic motor that turns a big rod that opens and closes the shades. And then we also have some just regular old electric motors that do it. But to answer your question, the signaling is electronic nowadays.
So all these brass tubes, these are all the, this is the, you said it runs off of vacuum, not pressure?
Yeah, this is the vacuum line.
So you have an upstairs. We saw all the generators for the pressure lines. You have another one in the is the vacuum generated here in the console?
No, there's a line that goes down and up, and that's on the in one of the blower rooms on the second floor mezzanine.
So it is. It moves quite a ways.
Yeah.
I also notice. Some boards stuck here and there testing or
no? That's the there's a new swell or no? It's the we have an indicator up there. So these guys are, I I forget when they're from, but these are the swell shoe indicators that tell you how far open or closed the different swell shades are. Right. And underneath that, there's a little, you know, a bunch of seven sigma displays that show you which memory level you're on.
It's very cramped in here.
Yeah.
Very cramped.
Sure.
Let's see this. All these solenoids.
Actually, come on out.
Look in from this side, too.
All right. Look at all those pipes. I'm just looking at all the vacuum pipes. They're just. It's amazing.
So they did their best to make this so you could get at it. It's a little catch, and so you can open this and get at these a little bit. Not a lot of light in there, but you can imagine having to take out or adjust those little tiny screws all the way in there. We did, in 2009, take the console apart. There's actually an oak frame on the inside, and all the mahogany here is just sort of dressing the frame, and it's put together with brass ferrules set into the wood and machine screws that hold it together. So it's made to be taken apart. So all the components came apart, you know, like this whole sort of wing here.
Wow.
There's a camera on there, I won't move it. But so we took it all apart and had the mahogany exterior refinished in 2009 and 10. And while it was apart, you can see there's this piece of aluminum here and these plates. If you can see these screws here, they used to go right into the backside of the wood on the front here. And we made some aluminum sort of braces here and made it so these now screw into the aluminum. So you can take this whole wooden kind of corner off and these will stay up. They used to just come loose, which, you know, we had to cut blocks to support them while we did that. But we made it so the wood can now come off. So if we really needed to get in here and we couldn't, just from here, we could actually take this off. But, you know, we try not to have to do that.
I can imagine the disassembling and reassembling nightmare of this, because not only do you have all of the layers of all these relays with the solenoids, but you have all these vacuum lines that are also have to be lined up. And so it looks like an alignment nightmare. Front and the back.
Yeah, and it's got to be airtight. And then, so if you come over here, let's see. This actually never got completely reconnected.
Or dusted.
Or dusted, probably. You can see some of. Some of the pneumatics and the magnets, and you can also see these beautiful giant-sized half-blind dovetails that were used to construct the console. Yeah.
And this console was built here in this building in the organ factory on the 12th floor.
12th?
In the late 20s. It's the third console that this organ has had. Because the organ has been expanded since its original installation in 1911.
This is the third console?
Yes.
That's just a total treat. Thanks, guys. Yeah. Thanks. Wow. Really something. Wanamaker Organ.
The idea is you have a whole lot of them on hand, so if they go bad, you can just open the chest and replace the ones that are bad. A little bit of a mess, but this is the shop.
It's like a wood shop to me.
So yeah, so this is the wood shop.
Well, that does look like it's got some history to it.
Oh, the workbench?
Yeah.
Yeah, there were five or six of those here in the old shop that were just kind of piled with junk, and so I took this one and flattened the top years ago. And it's probably not flat anymore, but flat on the top and cleaned it up and use it for what it was originally intended, which is nice.
There's just so many hours in a bench like this.
Yeah.
I can only even imagine. Wow.
That's true. I saved from Sam.
What
That is part of the a mechanical combination action from a whirlet. No, that's from a molar. A molar theater organ that we took out of a church in Baltimore and rebuilt and installed at in St. Clement's Church on 20th and Cherry.
It's very intricate.
Yeah, it's a mechanical, it's basically a mechanical memory. We didn't actually rebuild it, we just took it out and put in an electronic combination action, but it was too nice to throw away. So
mechanical memory. So what would something like this actually control? What would it need to remember?
Well, the stops, meaning like the voices in the organ that are on or off.
Oh, okay. That's a player piano.
It is. A little one. I got that from Craigslist. If you keep your eye on Craigslist, you can get player pianos for free.
Really?
Sometimes it's like, get this thing out of here.
So this is a free player piano.
Yeah.
We'll fix her upright.
And wouldn't hold. I mean, player pianos work on vacuum, not on pressure. But it wouldn't hold.
Right, because the paper roll, and it works on.
Yeah.
Right. So you use the same vacuum for the paper roll as you use for the bellows, and like to actually work the mechanism.
Exactly. And this wouldn't work because there were too many holes in the reservoir. So we actually got two shop vacs and plugged them into the two. ports that connect to what the reservoir was, and I forget how many inches a player piano works on, the inches of vacuum, but it's not that many, but I think a vacuum was like 70 inches or something. So we were running it on like way, way, way too much vacuum, and it made it play super loud and way too fast, but it was kind of fun.
So I spotted this, and this is an all plywood. Is it plywood? It's all solid.
Yeah, this has channeling in it, but.
But it's an all-wood vacuum pump.
So. Big wheel here that would be driven by a motor. This is the base right here. The motor would go on, and then the unit.
And on the inside, it's got this, I guess it's got the two pumps, I guess.
Four.
And four.
Yeah, right.
Four-way. Look at that.
So as it spins, it is drawing the air. And of course, this is old and leaky. But it would be drawing the air out of this. And compressing it, and this wants to go and open back up. So this is a vacuum reservoir.
Huh. Wow.
So it builds up.
So is this
more and more nothing?
Is this the original vacuum? One of the original vacuum?
No. I think this is from a. We just have a lot of stuff here. I don't know where that came from. This isn't from the organ. It's just.
But it's just a vintage vacuum pump.
Yeah.
Four bellows. That's pretty cool. Pretty neat. Modulation. Repulsion start modulation. Single phase motor. I've never heard it called that before. Repulsion start modulation.
Andy, maybe?
Yeah. He's copacetic. What the hell is this? This is part of the...
This is a big chest that we took out of the chorus division that we rebuilt, haven't put back in yet.
This is what the other side, we just saw the console. This is what's on the other side. This is what the receiving end of those controls.
Similarly, yeah, same magnets, different thing.
I love these magnets. Are these all, I guess these were not like maybe handmade or custom made. Are they, do you think they're custom made, or are these kind of units like off the shelf Bible at one point for the...
I think they were. I don't think these were...
Because there are thousands and thousands of these things.
Right? Yeah, there are. So we've been... there's a lot of junk. We've been here since... in this space since 2006. I've been here since 2005. When I started, the organ shop was in a little room on the second floor mezzanine, kind of tucked like around this corner. And to get to it, you had to actually go up some stairs, out a fire door, across an exterior fire escape, back in a door and around a corner, and then there was a sliding door and the organ shop was there. And the things we had to restore, you literally couldn't get around that first corner. There just were too long to go around the corner. In 2006, we got some grant money to kind of get started in earnest with the restoration of the organ. They've been having symposiums for a while before that, but that's when we started setting up a shop.
So we finally, we renovated the sixth, or what am I saying? We renovated the third floor mezzanine here and then moved our stuff up from the old shop space. I don't know.
I hear something crackling. Something's...
The crackling is this, it's this hide glue over here, I'm sure. Well, anyway, so yeah, we use hot melt, traditional hot melt hide glue. So Michael Lawrence must have just left. This is still a little warm, but it's just animal protein glue. It's unglamorous, but it's a traditional adhesive, and you can hydrate it and remove it with water. Water and heat, you can remove it.
So you keep that hot, and then it's you apply it hot to.
Yeah, I think about 140 is about where it's supposed to be. 135.
See, what are these?
So these are called Fleming pneumatics, named after William Boone Fleming, the gentleman in the photograph over there. So they're basically, so the way this organ works, and most organs these days, the way they work is you've got wind coming from blowers that puts pressure into wind chests that have valves that connect to underneath the pipes. And so the wind in the chest is allowed at the right moment to blow through the pipe and play a note. And the same wind that plays the pipes is also what creates most of the mechanical movement in the organ. So you've got a sealed tight wind chest that has pneumatics like this inside it. So this is just a wooden block with leather pouching on it and a leather valve, and inside there from the back there is a weak spring. We probably have some of those in here. And we reuse all the parts that we can from the original organ. And like I often say when people ask what my job is, I say my job is to meticulously reproduce the mistakes of the past. So we try to reuse as many things as possible. So there's a weak spring in there, and then the inside of the pneumatic block is connected to this opening here, which gets screwed to the inside of a chest, and this valve covers a hole, rather. And there's channeling that connects the inside of the pneumatic through this hole to the inside of the chest, so everything's in equilibrium. But there's when the organist plays a note, it sends 12 volts to an electromagnet, which lifts a little metal armature, which changes the channeling and connects the inside of the pneumatic to the atmosphere. So now you've got atmospheric pressure, which is lower inside the pneumatic, surrounded by high pressure in the chest, and so it collapses the pneumatic just because of the pressure differential.
And that allows that turns on the note.
Yeah, so that pulls the valve away from the opening inside the chest and lets the wind in the chest blow through that hole and play a note.
So it's two different levels of pressure at work. One for control, one for actually playing the organ.
No, they're the same.
Oh, the same.
Yeah, so this is in the wind chest. We can actually probably film inside. I can find something to open up that you can film, and I can describe this again when there's something to look at besides me holding the thing in the air.
And these are all like hand carved, hand worked pieces. It's like,
yeah, they're all original. They're just blocks of pine or poplar that were drilled out, and then they've been modified a bunch of times over the years. They used to have a little adjustable tension spring in here and a bunch of other parts that were long ago discarded. So Fleming, the guy in the photo over there, was very well known for engineering things that were so complicated that they didn't work. Or they did work, but they were over-engineered and over-complicated. And so they ended up, over the years, kind of removing some of the parts of these and simplifying them, and they worked just as well. So that's what all this, it looks like it's had a long life, and it has. But
How old are these parts? When was the organ assembled originally?
The organ was built in about three stages. The first part of the organ was built 1902-03 in Los Angeles, and was set up and working at the 1904 World's Fair in St. Louis. After that, Wanamaker acquired it, brought it here, got it set up in the store, and playing, I think, by 1911 was the sort of dedication. And then he felt like it wasn't loud enough, and so he started his own organ building shop in the building. At one point, there were 30 full-time employees, is what the book says. And they, in that shop, had two separate enlargement projects.
So the organ is now almost 29,000 pipes. It started out about 10,000.
29,000 pipes.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's a lot. And then there's got to be some sort of pneumatic valve to open and close the, you know, to allow or disallow the wind to play the pipes.
In every single one.
Yeah. And the leather lasts about 60 years, best case scenario.
Best case.
Yeah. If you do it right. If you did it wrong, it takes 10 years to find out. You know, and it's things like, I mean, it sounds silly, but you've got, you know, hide glue in here and you're gluing the leather to the pneumatic, and if you pull the brush away, it can kind of like make a little sort of string of hide glue, you know? And if you do that without paying attention and it dries to a little sharp point, the leather will wear out there more quickly than it should. But so it means that in 10 years, your pneumatics start failing instead of 50 or 60. But it still takes 10 years to find out that, like, that you didn't do it right. Like I said, there's lots of leather work. So we've got, it's like our leather station. We have a whole suite of punches.
Wow.
And they do get pretty big.
Wow.
We don't use them
That's
very
huge.
Often, but I know.
Yeah, I actually have. I have some of these up to like an inch in size, but
probably have to hit that pretty hard to make it.
Yeah, I don't.
Do its job. But here, I don't know. This in terms of leather work and punching, this is my favorite thing that we have. So you can take your one of these and one of those. And that's got a little bayonet, and now. Can make your own washers with whatever inside and outside diameter
cool.
that you want.
Oh, okay.
The cabinets here, these drawers, they all have these individual locks, and I think the keys are long gone. But he said that this was originally in the women's department, and they would give you a key, and you could lock your purse in here while you were shopping.
Wow.
Or trying on.
Historic.
So this is a bottom board that Ryan, these are actually new. These are for a high school that has a pipe organ in the Northeast. My shopmate Ryan built this thing. All of these. This is a different type of organ than the Wanamaker organ, but these are electromagnets. And here's the common. And there's leather gaskets. So everything in the organ, or in an organ that needs to be put together and airtight, they pretty much make leather or cork gaskets. Mostly leather these days, I believe. So that's what these are. This is the outer part of it. So here's the bottom of the magnets, and these unscrew so you can change the armatures.
So this is actually hollow.
Well, this gets screwed up. Well, we'll see more of this when we go in the organ. This gets screwed underneath a wind chest, and the holes in the gasket here each correspond to one of these magnets.
So there's actually there are tunnels inside of the board that channel the air.
They're drilled diagonally through the plywood.
Wow.
It takes a long time to make. So each of these holes here goes to one of these magnets, and basically when the magnet gets 12 volts, it lifts a little armature. Let's see if we can find one down here. So this would be, let's see, is it in there? Yeah, so, see the little metal armature.
Okay.
So there's a, just get put back in there properly. This is upside down now. This would be, overhead and like that onto the bottom of a chest. So generally, with pipe organs, you access the chests from underneath because on top, you've got all the pipes. So to open up, to get inside the chest from the top is a real pain because you have to take all the pipes off, put them in trays, take them out. Also, when you touch them, they go out of tune. So you can imagine tuning 29,000 pipes. It doesn't really happen very often. At least they're not. I mean, it's rarely. I mean, isn't it can't ever really be perfectly in tune because it's just too big. But anyway, these would go underneath a wind chest, and so what the electromagnets do is basically open this channel to the atmosphere by moving that little armature up or down under the magnet. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
We can look at something else. That might show that better. But that's the main principle that all of this stuff works on.
Ooh. This works pretty well in low light.
Oh, there you go.
I saw the and your main amp meter was running about 40 amps when the organ was playing.
Yeah, 12 volts.
But if that gauge is any...
Yeah, I think it can draw about 100 when it's going.
I was going to say the ampere meter goes to 400 amps, but does it ever really need that much?
Not that I've ever seen. This is the 2D, which is a thing that will let you play all of the organ on one manual. But you have to have someone come back here and manually adjust. You know, those are switches.
Right.
So you have to have someone come back here and manually set it.
So this is just for this one console here, so you can play it from inside of the organ? Or this is a...
Well, no, this is attached to the console,
oh, okay.
You know, the main console. And there's a tab that says 2D. I think there's three or four of them, maybe? Three, maybe? Yeah, so there's 2D1, 2D2.
And... Oh, I see. 2D. It says right there.
Yeah.
On the...
So you can come back here and set... I mean, these are actual switches. Just when you turn this, it just closes the contact. So you can come back here and set things ahead of time. But generally, I think the organists don't really use it. But it's actually very handy for troubleshooting because the whole, all the switching or the signaling for the whole organ comes through here. So I think in the, you know, the idea of dividing things in half to find where the problem is, you know?
Right.
So you divide it in half, and then you find which half, and then you divide that in half to try to chase out a problem. This isn't, I think, technically, like, in half, but it's an easy place to get to.
There's a bunch of different types of chests in the organ here. And this, the design on this doesn't actually have brass ferrules. It has these little clips you just turn. But I like these nice quarter-sawn oak panels here. So... take this down. You can see everything is recently re-leathered. So in here you've got, so if you look in here you can see there's a row of electromagnets. Each corresponds to a note. And so this magnet, when it gets 12 volts, will through a channel in the wood exhaust this pneumatic, which moves this little threaded rod, and it only has to move that tiny amount. So that closes, so this pneumatic here is connected through a channel in the wood to this opening. So when this pneumatic collapses, it closes this opening and opens one up here, which goes to the atmosphere. So then the channel to this pneumatic is connected to atmosphere, so it collapses. And that pulls this rod, which opens this valve here, which then opens the channel through the backboard here up to the channel in the bottom board, then exhausts to atmosphere. So it's primary, secondary pneumatic, which then exhausts the channel that runs through. Maybe I should get a screwdriver. I can take a bottom board down.
Oh, that's the bottom board for the pipe, so...
Hand tools.
It's another one of those great desks.
Yeah. Huh.
You want to grab, put them in a cup or? Oh, absolutely.
Or do you want to film?
I'm doing both. Okay. I'm multitasking in a supreme way. So those are tapped into like a brass or steel.
Yeah, there are brass ferrules in the chest.
So they built this to be constantly maintained, mm-hmm. And yeah. I was reading the book, so I've gotten a little bit of background about how it's put together and sort of for the exposition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a showpiece for sure.
So the interesting thing to me is that from the very beginning, they've always had a fake facade for the organ, because in the exposition they had a facade, and here mm-hmm. they built a completely different one for this location. So it just seems, well, maybe it's not odd, but that from the beginning, they knew that they would have to present something to the public to make them...
Something more than what was...
Yeah, instead of just like a, instead of a wall of louvers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is... it did say in the book that the at one point in the exhibition, the organist hit a low note and a part of the ceiling detached from the exhibition hall.
That sounds as legendary as it, more legendary than true. But yeah, I did see that in the book.
Yeah,
it maybe.
Well, it makes a good story. Yeah.
No, I don't. Not the ceiling falling down. I just mean the organ in general.
Well, for an organist, it makes a good story to say that, you know, that they literally brought the house down. Yeah. Literally.
Well, we got all the bolts out. Yeah, we gotta get like a little stubby to get in there.
Where's that right angle one you found?
Yeah, that could work. It's a little...
Yeah, I don't like those either, personally, but...
It's a little small for how big those are, but...
A pinch.
It's quicker than a trip to the shop.
Well, just to get it going, and then, you know...
So when we rebuilt... When we rebuild a division, we basically do all of this at once. We take this whole thing apart all at once and take all of it up to the shop. Basically put it in the hallway in a giant pile. Actually, your camera is small enough. You could probably hook it up in there and have a look at the channels.
Oh.
Okay.
Well, I got one left in there in the corner. There's a... That one right there.
Like this?
No, closer.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank you. Here's those. Okay. So, here's the last bolt. Okay. So, now, turn this down.
Wow, look at that plank. That is so thick. It's like 2 inches thick.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's laminated, you can see from the edge. So there's channeling through there.
Oh, it's a box. It's like a hollow box. So there are channels carved in there to distribute the wind to the different pipes.
Yeah, so each of these holes is connected by a channel, and they all go to pipes of the same pitch. But you can see the spaces here correspond with the chests that have the different ranks on them. So, if you look...
Wow.
So there are the Flemings.
There's a lot in there.
Yeah. So, I should look. We have a Fleming screwdriver somewhere. I'll have to go get it from upstairs. But so these are the Fleming blocks that you saw Mike rebuilding in the shop.
Yeah.
And so the bottom board mates with these holes. And it's funny because we rebuilt this in 2010, 2011 maybe, and look how dirty it's gotten already.
That's just from the air.
That's just
pushed
dirt in the air, yeah.
Well, that's the city.
Yeah, so each of these holes goes up into one of those pneumatics, and they're all connected by a channel through the board. And then if you can get the camera up here and look, you can see, like, if you see, actually this is nice. It's all from the original organ. There's these punching of the notes, so... You can feel an opening here which would mate with the gasketic part of the end of the bottom board.
So it's a D.
See right here? So these are the channels. So magnet gets 12 volts, which collapses this pneumatic, basically opens this pneumatic to the atmosphere, so it collapses because it's got pressure around it, so it collapses, which opens this valve, which collapses this pneumatic, which opens this bigger valve underneath here, which goes through the backboard that this is mounted to, and up to this opening here, which mates with the hole in the bottom board, which exhausts that whole channel to atmosphere. So now you've got all these pneumatics in the chests that are trying to be played all at once, but only the chests that have pressure in them, because the stop tab is turned on, will actually collapse the pneumatic and make the
So that's how that's how the paddle controls work then at the organ console. They determine which ones turn on and off when they hit a specific.
Exactly. This is a ventil chest. So this thing here is called the stop action. So this, when you turn on one of the stops, will put wind into the corresponding chest.
So it's a grid. It's a matrix. So
exactly.
You've got, okay, so you got notes this way, and you have selections this way.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right.
Exactly. And it only puts wind into, at least in this type of chest, it only puts wind into the chests that have ranks that are turned on. So you don't have to have the whole organ pressurized all at once, which
makes
sense. And
that's for every single division has its own set of controls like this. So mm-hmm. for every, and so how many divisions are there? Separate.
Oh, well, there's 460 ranks.
460 ranks.
I believe, yeah. But as for divisions, I'm not sure.
Okay. That's it. Thanks for tuning in and being patient and waiting for part two of the Wanamaker Organ. Thanks to Scott and Matt. And I'm Fran. I'll be back. Thanks for watching. Bye. Historic John Wanamaker building for some basic maintenance. The organ, you can hear them testing it in the background. It gets played twice a day, and with all that playing, the pipes get pretty dirty, so they've invited me in here to help them clean the pipes. So I'm here with Matt Taft, who you remember from the last video, and yeah, it seems to be a pretty interesting adventure, so let's go.
Howdy.
So we're gonna clean organ pipes. How often is this?
Organ pipes.
So there's normally like 30,000 pipes in the organ?
Yes.
So I imagine this is a constant process, like a never-ending process of cleaning the organ.
If you were doing upkeep the entire time. And that's not what has happened over the history of this instrument. And the section of pipes we're washing now has water damage from 1928.
Okay, so it's a little long on the agenda.
It's a little long on the agenda, but the section we've taken out is about 1,200 pipes. And that is the back half of one chamber. And that represents about 3-4% of the entire instrument. And that's a 6 month to a year long process when we've got two people working on it. So
okay.
On top of the other upkeeps that we do and putting out all the fires here and there. Yeah.
All right, 1,200 pipes. Well, okay, we'll see what we can knock out in one afternoon.
Out of 1,200? At least two.
So we've got a narrow window between the afternoon performance and the evening performance to do any kind of work on the organ. Although, it was running. I guess the blowers were running because I heard them playing with the notes.
We did have them on. Kurt was troubleshooting.
Because that stuck note, there was a stuck note yesterday or a not working note.
Which you saw when you came. Yeah.
Yeah, which I did not hear.
And that's the problem, that we didn't hear the note. So that was on the agenda to fix today. So every now and then you get one note that just decides to stop working, and then you've got to go figure out why. So you stop what you're doing in the proactive restoration of something, and then you have to go to the reactive, we need to fix this so this part keeps working.
And this is the special Westinghouse elevator. They knocked the roof out so that they could actually move longer pipes, because I guess when the original restoration, Scott said that the elevator wasn't big enough, they couldn't move the pipes, so.
This elevator is less than 12 feet wide.
12 feet wide,
and we have pipes that start at 16 feet, and that's a good average length.
So the ceiling was expanded.
With an extra chimney, so you can put things diagonal
exactly.
From front to back, top to bottom.
And here we go, the organ shop.
Come around the corner. There's more floor space than you've ever seen in here before.
Yeah, it's quite empty here.
Yeah. Out of the 1,200 pipes, we've put back already at least 600.
No, this is newly put in place because I didn't see this here before.
Or was this here all along and I just kept
this thing was here all along.
So it was covered with a table or something? Or
sometimes if we have a big symposium of people here and we're working, we'd like to feed them on the last day, and we'll put planks of wood across the top of the sinks, and then it'll be a big buffet table. But under the buffet table
is the pipe cleaning sink.
Two bays of a sink. One is for rinsing the pipes. We like to rinse the dirt off first and then stick them in the cleaning solution.
So the rinse and soak, and well, it's like, you know, anyone who's worked in a restaurant, and yeah. You know, you have the washing and the rinsing sink. Yeah. So now that you use a solution, so it's a slightly acidic solution, right?
It'll sit in the solution for up to 5 minutes as you use a gentle pad to get any extra dirt off of it. We don't want anything to scour the metal. Some of the metal is quite soft. It's so soft it will dent with the pressure of your fingers. So you have to hold the pipe firmly, but not too firmly, kind of like a pet hamster. But some of the pipes you need to hold more like a hummingbird.
I was going to imagine that the lead alloy would be easy to deform a pipe. So, okay, there you go.
So after it sits in the solution for up to 5 minutes, we get it as cleaned off as you can, and it goes on the inside of the pipe too. And these pipes have been sitting there untouched for over 100 years in most cases.
It dirt smells sweet. It has a sweet smell. Candy or food, or
I wonder if that's part of the shellac that gets on the wood, and if it is evaporating into the air, organs have a funny smell to them inside, and they're all different.
It's hard to describe. It's like a very old, stale, sweet smell, like if you were in a abandoned Victorian candy store.
Confectionery.
It's like 100-year-old sugar. It has a sugar. I wonder if maybe there was a sugar component to something in preserving.
The wood is sugar pine.
Well, maybe
it's got something to do with the wood.
Could be a syrup, like a syrup thing.
I used to work on other pipe organs throughout the country, and there's a problem with some. If the wood isn't cured properly, there is still sap in it. And the sap, after it's been in the organ for 20 or 50 years, may start to come out, and the valves will stick against the sappy wood.
The stairway that goes to nowhere.
Yes. As far as I understand, they didn't want to lease all the space up to the fifth floor. They didn't want it for all their retail space. So they said, well, we don't really need above the fourth floor. So between 3 and 4, they cut the stairways off and poured floor. So we just have stairways that go into a ceiling. That used to be the main stairways to get through the store, which was 12 stories of retail space. And now it's the Wanamaker department store cut it down to 5 stories. And then later another tenant cut it down to 3 stories. And that's where Macy's continues to operate out of.
So it was originally the whole building?
Yes.
Wow. That's hard to imagine, because I've never known it more than like 5 stories.
Yeah.
So,
the entire building. There was a toy store, I think it was on the 7th floor, and they had a monorail that would go through and drop you off in the toy store. I don't know if it went through the Grand Court, but you could ride the monorail, and there were some great pictures.
I can imagine doing 12 foot stories, and these are 12 foot floors. They're not residential floors.
There's a really amazing picture of this building while it was being constructed. It was finished in 1911, and so the picture's probably from a year or two before, and it was built in 3 sections. You've got the main center atrium of the 7-story open Grand Court, and then each wing of the building, Chestnut Street and Market Street, and there are thick firewalls in between. They built each one separately, and it was so tall and massive, they had to compensate for how much the ground was going to compress. So they had to build it higher than where this was so it would sink down and line up, which is amazing to think about, especially when you look at this photograph and see horse-drawn carriages with construction supplies lining the circumference of the building. And this was built with human hands and horses and like train cars delivering supplies. And that was, it's 12 stories tall. It's a whole city block wide. There's almost 45 acres of floor space in this building. You know, all figured out before computers and...
Yeah, it's amazing, you know, and you know, people don't believe we went to the moon because they didn't have powerful enough computers and they didn't have, you know,
isn't a computer AutoCAD, just one who computes? Like,
that is true. That's the thing. There were computers. That's that they were people.
Humans.
They were
yeah.
people
yeah.
who computed.
Yeah.
So, who is this guy?
Ooh, here we go. E.M. Skinner.
Oh. Ernest M. Skinner, who built some of the greatest American symphonic organs of the early 20th century.
And if you talk to most organ enthusiasts, they will know what a Skinner organ is. And for some people, that was the cream of the crop, the heyday of organ building. E.M. Skinner built the best of the best. And there are some things about that that are true and some things that it's a matter of preference and opinion, really. But he did fantastic work, and that is, I think, all around accepted. It's just who's done the best work.
It also should be noticed that there are always piano players and organ players hanging around, so that there's always
live music.
There's always live music coming from somewhere, from someone playing pianos.
What? And we couldn't do what we do without the volunteers that we have. It just takes so much labor to manually get everything done that we can. It's not like you can put these pipes in a dishwasher and then just come back and it's done. Every single one needs to be carefully worked on. And that's just cleaning, the each one gets restored, and all the any dents that are in it from mishandling or being bumped into, or just the weight of the pipe sitting over time being concentrated where they are mounted, will collapse the metal. And there's skilled artisans that will craft that back out. And it's just so many little fine details.
They deform just from their own weight.
Just naturally, kind of like a whale being beached. It will, its lungs will collapse because it can't, its muscles can't support all that weight. And that's what happens with some of the pipes. You might be able to see some of that evidence here. If you look in the toe of the pipe, it's a little deformed. This one isn't too bad, but it is, that is definitely small. Yeah. But the entire weight of the pipe sits on this lead toe.
Yeah, I see. It is a little flattened. Yeah. Interesting.
Sort of a schematic, a diagram of how the back half of the chamber is laid out. We just tape it up against the wall because this is the order that we need to wash the pipes in. We've already done the front half of the choir. It's been taken out, restored, put back, and is functioning. You can play it from the console now. And the back half of the choir, the first two reeds are out for restoration, so those will be the last things to come in. So we'll start at the very back wall of the chamber, farthest away from the shades, which are behind the golden facade pipes. So the very first rank is the Dulciana, and we've already finished that. So we just labeled them 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th. So we've completed the first two out of 10 ranks, and we're on the third one, the Geigen Principal. Also labeled the Violin Diapason at the console.
The Geigen Principal?
Geigen Principal.
Okay.
There, somebody was explaining to me that they didn't want sort of foreign languages on the tabs of the console as they made a new console. The one that's there now is the third console that's been here, and it was built by the organ factory on the 12th floor here. The entire console was built in this building, which is really remarkable to think about that craftsmanship and just the massive size of it. It might be 2 tons, don't quote me on that, but we can look up the metric measurement. And it's just this huge piece of furniture, musical instrument, command cockpit kind of area where you've got the 5 keyboards, one for your feet, and hundreds of tabs. And that was made here. So when more ranks were added and the console needed to expand and be restored and upgraded, they made new tabs. And the tabs are all plain English names. So our documentation in the chamber, the original pipes from the early 1900s, are labeled one thing, and eventually it got labeled something else. So the documentation that exists in the organ, when you walk in to troubleshoot something, the organist will say, this tab, the violin diapason, C-sharp 2 isn't working. So you go get your documentation, and it says violin diapason, but you know in the chamber it's labeled Geigen principle. Because 100 years ago, that's what they called it. And over the time...
So you have your own translation book for the organ itself, as its own language.
Yeah.
So,
And it's and in order, so we have one of these pages for every division.
These are super shiny.
These are ones that have been washed and finished.
Yeah. Big difference. I mean, these are like, you know, new metallic shine,
yeah.
Clean.
Yeah. Hey.
Hey, speak of the devil.
Yeah. I think I washed pipes with this.
That's a great idea.
Yeah?
Do we have enough gloves for everyone?
I brought my own. Are these ready to go back in, or are these waiting for other work?
These are waiting for their leather lips to be reinstalled. There was actually a piece of leather installed on the top part of the mouth that affects the air curtain that comes out, which changes how the pipe sounds.
Oh, this is different tones.
Yes.
So the pipes we're going to be doing today, these are going to be removed, washed, and put back.
They were already removed.
Oh, okay, they're already out.
But they will be, they've been removed and put in trays and brought up here, and now we're ready to take them out of the trays, wash them, dry them. If there's some minor repairs we can do, we'll take care of that. And if they're, we'll get them sprayed, and if they're dried by the time we're ready to, before you have to go, we might be able to get them in the chamber, have a little passing party.
All right.
Yeah.
It's a Sony U-matic. VP7020. That's a piece of history.
All right. So this is our voicing studio. And freshly restored clean pipework comes in here for the finishing touches. There's an empty wind chest with racking, and we can set the pipes up over here. It's got its own little blower. And you can put the pipes in all the holes and play them, adjust the sound. This is a sample pipe that was being made to show the different the construction.
Oh, I see. So you can change the tone or the voicing, I guess.
And how high is this? Is the mouth going to be a very shallow opening? And that affects the sound quality.
And so you have this would be tone, and then this would be tuning
for the
at
pitch.
The top. That's
yes.
It. So it's pitch and tone. So and now on the metal pipes, you notice that there's a curl. They curl the metal. I guess that they
a scroll.
Yeah, that's what it's called, a scroll.
Yes.
So they can fine tune that aperture to.
And if it doesn't have a scroll, it will probably have a tuning collar, which is.
I've
just
seen that too. It's a sliding. Like I guess it's held by tension, and it can be moved.
Yeah, it's a nice snug fit and. That is what you'll see new on top of some of these Geigen principle pipes.
I saw a whole box of them. They're like, I guess they're replaceable. So.
And some of the newer ones are a nicer quality metal. And
yeah, wow, you'll see that. Yeah.
Some of the earlier ones that are on some of the pipes in this instrument are not finely made, and it's sort of just... It's very crude, where it's sort of just like a scroll of metal that's really like held tight, kind of like a spring, and that sometimes it's too tight and it pinches the pipe and over time deforms the metal. So that's what we come in here with these rods. And
okay.
If you're trained on how to do it, you put the rod in and then hammer out the indent on the pipe.
Okay, so this is actually for truing the pipes, getting them into round again.
Yes. And there's lots of fun tools.
Yeah, I was
going
to say, these are very interesting jigs, like this wooden piece here for, this is, you know, for, I guess, for holding pipes of different sizes and shaping them, I guess.
So it's not just rolling around on the table, I suppose.
Right. You need lots of tools and jigs. Look at this.
It's wonderful.
That is antique.
Yeah.
So that's an abrasive for
or it was
polishing.
A polishing cloth, and if you need, maybe it's such a large flat surface, I would suppose it's to help shape the pipe.
Could ask Scott, I guess, if he's...
Scott made his replacement one, so he knows exactly what that's for.
But okay.
This is definitely not the area that I usually work in. I bring the pipes to them and then allow the voicers and restorers to finish that part of the work.
They're just amazing tools and such.
And this is where a reed would sit on here in a pipe.
I see. So it's for adjustment or installation?
This is a part of... It says Wanamaker on it.
Yeah.
Part of the reed pipe. It was probably out for restoration.
That's actually part of a reed pipe.
Yes, yeah, so okay. This would be in the toe, and this... I might need to be corrected, but this is the shallot. Shallot? The accent on which syllable? It's not the one that sounds like the onion. It's the other one.
Shallot?
Shallot onion. So this is the shallot, and then the reed would sit on top of here, and the reed vibrates up and down, and then there's a tuning wire that would go through the hole, and this pushes down along that surface of the reed, so it vibrates at a different pinch point. So if you have a ruler, which I'm sure we have one around here.
Actually, it does say Wanamaker on it. Strange that it's actually written Wanamaker on it. As if it could be fall into some other organ.
Yes.
In this building. But this is a really amazing little construction.
Yeah.
A handmade switch panel there, a nice piece of hardwood, and all made from scratch, I'm sure.
The craftsmanship of this instrument is a tradition that is important to continue carrying on. And we take great pride in doing things well.
Look at the grain of this wood. This is just totally out of hand. This, and that goes on. I'm like, how? Is this like old growth? How old is this? I'm gonna say because this.
Scott probably built this for us, so he definitely
will
tell you.
I'm just looking at the number of rings here. Unless this is cut, and it must be cut from several different pieces. But that's amazing.
It's beautiful wood.
Look at that, and the rings go on and on and on and on. It's like, I hope this wasn't cut out of a
zebra grain. Oh,
yeah. I hope it wasn't cut out of a, you know, 16-foot diameter, you know, tree.
Giant. Yeah.
It's and there's the wind chest.
Our reservoir of pressurized air, and the
it's
springs
reservoir, yeah.
Hold that tension.
And there's even as for longer pipes down here.
The taller pipes, and you see.
Oh, yeah.
To tie them up so they don't tip over.
Tip over, yeah.
And that's just like the pipes against that wall on our new racking system to hold them up.
Yeah.
Because if you just lean them against the wall, it's a bit precarious.
Yeah.
have a terrible domino effect, and it's all the pipes you've just washed, and they're antiques. They're over 100 years old, so.
This is obviously very old, that these testing. Did these date back to the original, as old as the organ, these testing fixtures? Or
if they were originally used as testers for the organ, or if they were part of the organ that got replaced or upgraded.
So just, yeah, I see, like, perhaps removed.
And as Kurt says, parts is parts. So we repurpose a lot of things. If we're going to take something out and make a new replacement for it, it's not necessarily... What's been taken out doesn't always go to the trash.
Mm. It says here, this is a Skinner voicing chest. So there you go.
E.M. Skinner.
Yeah. This is an Aeolian Skinner voicing chest. Uh-huh. Amazing.
This is a nice bright room, and the voicers can do all that fine, meticulous work in a quiet area where you need to control the quality of sound of the pipes and manipulate it so they all sound cohesive.
Yeah. These are all cleaned. Ready to move.
Okay, but just give it gentle support all the way across. There we go.
Watch the light.
Oh yeah, it's just barely gonna fit in here.
And you want to put it down with that.
So it's a very mild solution that we get most of the surface dirt and any like excess oxidation sort of off. So that's why some of the pipes look, these turned to the spotted tin, look so
it's
shiny.
Because like,
The acids in your fingers, when if you handle them without gloves, when there isn't a sealant on them, it will oxidize the pipes. So we take off any surface level oxidation and dirt, definitely dirt and dust, off the outside and the inside, and then we seal it with a de-waxed shellac.
Shellac, makes sense. I think that's actually what you're smelling in there. I think it is
it's
the shellac.
Probably a lot of the shellac.
The shellac, sweet smell.
Restart piano.
This is a part of the original swell control. These are the original, what the original relays look like. In fact, see the label, relay. It says, this is the relay for the great chimes. These are solo chimes. This original contacts in here. Contacts. It's amazing. Original relays.
They should be in the voicing room or in the workshop. Or
these are parts of the percussive mallets from...
That is the custom-built action for a 6-foot Chinese gong.
Yeah. Oh, gong. Yeah, look at that.
So when are y'all putting it back together?
Well, this is they are brand new design. So the gong, it was struck by hand for a sporting event, like out in a field.
It's so big, I can't get in one shot, but that's...
These are the warm-up mallets that will vibrate back and forth to get the...
I have a nice gong?
So that's the warm-up mallets. That's when, like, it gets the roar of the gong going. And then this big actuator. So one big bellows just for one strike.
One action for one strike, yeah. And
wow.
Kurt has devised a method to vary the pressure that this striking bellows will have. So when you control the expression, you can have the striking mallet strike softer or louder.
All done in wood. Even these small pieces, that's all wood. That's not brass. That's like all very finely tooled wood. It's just amazing, this thing open like this. There's like...
This is the chorus third diapason chest.
Third diapason chest.
And it sits in the back of the great chorus, at the very top in the center, the most newly restored section of the organ. And it's a very heavy chest because it has all of its own magnet rails inside of it. And this is the different style pouching instead of the individual Fleming pneumatics.
Yes, I was looking at these. Is that these? Is it, this is rubber and this is all leather.
Oh, this is all leather.
All
then
leather.
This is a synthetic felt and then a leather valve on top.
Right. So that is different than the other ones that I looked at last time. Yeah.
And so there we've got the pouch rail. There is the.
This has that. This
performs the same function that one of these Flemings would do. So when the air inside of this pouch gets exhausted, when the electrical signal goes to the magnet pulling the armature up, it allows the air in the pouch to flood out to atmosphere, and this is all filled with pressurized air, so this collapses, and then the air comes up through the toes of this and in through one pipe.
So yeah, but every one of these valves is actually a two-stage action. So you've got actually two set. There's one valve that opens up that creates enough pressure to open up a larger valve.
Yes.
That then actually turns on the note.
And in this one,
so,
it has another secondary down here. So there's one thing makes the second thing happen, which makes this third thing happen.
So it's doom, doom, doom. For every note, it's one, two, three.
For these larger notes,
these,
yes, but the other one doesn't have that secondary one.
It's just
because
of the size of the valve.
Electromagnet.
The force needed to open the valve.
Precisely.
Yeah. But yeah, three actions just for one note.
And so one note, often, if you look at this side where the toe board is, the spacing of these is further apart than the spacing of those valves. And that's because for some of these lower notes, there are two valves. So you'll have two, and two things happen to make one note play. And that's when...
So you got the opportunity, because that, and so for maintenance, you have to have both those valves open for the note to play, so if one of them doesn't work, you don't
or
have enough air.
Or if one's very slow to come on, it's slow and breathy to come up.
Right, yeah, a lot of challenges with the larger notes. Well, that's, on the last video, you were mentioning how the delay time is extended with the longer pipes, and I guess this just extends that because you have three different actions, just open the valves, and then you have, of course, the length of the pipes, which takes longer for them to actually turn on.
Yes.
Because the air has to go further. And then, of course, they're deep in the organ, so they're further away. So
acoustical delay. And then imagine when it was physical and mechanical relays that would send the signals to different parts of the organ. So it was, step one, two, three, and then maybe four, five, six.
So that's the thing. I would like to hear like a recording of the early organ, because it seems like with someone playing like any kind of a piece, that it would almost not, that there would be so many, that there would be errors that you'd be hearing all the time. Like,
it's been described as a waterfall effect, and the notes kind of just blend and mush together.
So just be like a big roar,
And there are some descriptions. There are some organists that could play and let go, and then the signals would keep. So you would have more notes happening after you let go.
This is how I want to spend my trip. This is amazing.
Are you not from here?
I'm from Austin, Texas. Yeah.
I've been there once.
Yeah.
Make sure you get it all out to the bridge.
That's a good move. Do you want another scrubby?
So, if you want, you can go pick up another pipe and do that.
Shiny day for this pipe today. It's like a caterpillar turning into a butterfly. Rich.
how long have you been washing pipes?
Like me personally, I guess, since I've been here, which is only 2 months. I haven't been here for too long, but...
2 months of pipe washing is still a lot of pipes.
I mean, I've been doing other stuff too, but the act of pipe washing is kind of a good beginner's thing in this business. And it happens that a lot of pipe washing needs to be done at this moment, because this is all of the wire chamber. I've been washing pipes for 5 years.
5 years all told. Yeah.
In here, the only air that's coming in is what's being blown through this nozzle. But when you have it back here, it's pulling more air in with it, so it's more volume going through.
Yeah. Fair volume, yeah.
Yeah.
I just thought that that's a very neat, it's scientific
principle
of
physics.
It's like a carburetor. You're the piano guy.
Yeah.
The traveling piano guy with the little piano.
Traveling piano.
In your car.
Its name is Little Bertha.
Little Bertha. That's awesome.
I have a big Bertha. That was my theater piano.
What was the name of the dishwasher that when I was a dishwasher?
Everyone's used to call got a Little Bertha and Big Bertha.
Yeah.
Cool. Everyone's got one in their life.
People who have an interest are just here and paths cross and it's like, hey, I'm free to volunteer. How's tomorrow? That's great, we're washing pipes, come on in. Oh, hey, I do a YouTube channel. Can I come film with you? Yes, that's perfect.
I wish I had this kind of access at a lot of the museums that I try to, you know, video in. It's like, that there's like zero politics with the Wanamaker organ, but, you know, with other artifacts, it can be very, very tough with the politics, especially these days. It wasn't always like that, but, seems like it's that way very recently, like,
yeah.
You know, the last 10-15 years, the curators tell me, the museums have changed. I wish it wasn't that way. It's just that museums have gone from things like the Wanamaker organ, where it's about public interest, to being like a for-profit company that has to look at its artifacts like assets, like money in the bank, or like proprietary information, you know, so they guard everything very, very, very secretly.
Very closely. That's a trend that I think happens in multiple industries, and it is something that happened in the leather industry, which affected the organ world. And the secrets of the trade were held so closely and then not passed on. So we ended up with only vegetable tan leather that lasted 5 years, and by the time you finished doing part of an organ, you'd have to redo it again. So they tried some synthetic materials, Perflex, rubber cloth, and they are bad news bears at some degree. And you get to a certain point, and they just get so brittle and crack and fail. But then chrome tan leather came about. But there was this amazing leather that was available 100 years ago
and the industry changed and all the secrets got lost because they were held so closely and tightly.
All right, well, that's going to do it for this one. Thanks for watching. And thanks, too, to all of my Patreon subscribers for making all these videos possible. And also thanks to Matt Taft and the friends of the Wanamaker Organ. I'll see you next time. I'm Fran. Bye.